Good afternoon, everybody. I'm supposed to wait to 3:10, but depends on what glasses you have on as to whether you know what time it is. Delighted you could join us. I'm standing behind the podium just because there's a microphone here. I'm Sharon Pratt, and I am the founding director of the Institute of Politics, Policy, and History. And we are very delighted and honored to be a part of our state university, the University of the District of Columbia. Indeed, it is the University of District of Columbia and our mayor, Mayor Muriel Bowser, the executive office of the mayor, that made it possible for IPPH to exist to get started. So just to give you a flavor of who we are, which I'm going to make very brief because we're here to talk about the topic of the day, is IPPH was launched for the purpose of rediscovering the history of our city, a very unique city, a city that was created out of whole cloth to serve a brand new nation. And we believe that if we can capture data points from that history, we will also have data points that will help to illuminate conversations about touchstone issues of the day, which segues also into our panel of the day. Now, just to let you know, IPPH, while it had some initial dollars from the Executive Office of the Mayor and the University of the District of Columbia, ultimately by the fiscal year 2020, we are to become a standalone nonprofit, but continue to be housed at the University of the District of Columbia. So I'm going to do to you as my church does to me every Sunday and let you know that while we have some support from the government, we will not have much support from the government moving forward. We have a place on our website where you can make donations, $10, $25. Those small donations, as Bernie Sanders and others will tell you, that is golden. And so we would love, if you want continued programming like this, we would welcome your support because you are a part of this colloquy that we're going to have on an ongoing basis. Now, before I get any further, I want to also introduce to you two members of our Senior Advisory Committee because we are that sort of standalone entity. We have a governing entity called the Senior Advisory Committee. And Dr. Charlene Drew Jarvis is a founding member of the SAC, as we call it. And then Dean April Massey, who is the Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, is another member here who is participating here today. I don't know. And we have some members of the Board of Trustees with us. Would they stand, please, of the University of the District of Columbia? Thank you, guys. You guys have been terrific. You were there for the launch and here today. A lot of people kind of get lost. We've got a number of people en route, but we want to get started out of respect for our panelists' time. I will give you just a big picture overview, and then I'm going to, turn it over to them. We have, I should say, some staff here as well who are available to you if you have any questions. Jody Samuda, Amy Anthony, and our senior advisor volunteer, Gretchen Wharton. So they are here as well as a resource. Mary Ann French will be the moderator. And Mary Ann French is a senior executive here at the University of the District of Columbia. She's also was a reporter, correspondent with the Washington Post, and her doctoral studies focus is on the South and particularly enslaved families of Virginia, which is very relevant to how this kind of topic emerged in recent days. We also have Dr. Dwandalyn Reece. Dr. Reece is somebody you probably have seen on with Van Jones or with Gayle King. She's been all over the news recently. She is a very distinguished curator of music and performing arts at the Smithsonian Institution for African American History. We have as well Doron Ezickson. Doron is quite a figure. He is the Washington, D.C. Metro Regional Director of the Anti-Defamation League. And then we have Dr. Bobby Austin, who at one time was also a vice president at this university, a noted author and sociologist. And so Marianne French will be able to moderate the discussion. You at some point will participate. Dr. Reece will give us the origins, the history, its original purpose and significance of blackface. As against us just going off on a tangent, she's going to put it in the context of its real history. Doron Ezickson will talk about an organization whose overarching mission, the Anti-Defamation League, is to address symbols of hate, symbols that dehumanize aspects of our society. So when we have the conversation, for those who say, let bygones be bygones, he can talk about why you don't necessarily want to do that. You may not pounce on the person, but you want to pounce on the symbol. Dr. Bobby Austin is somebody who is a true sociologist. He can talk about why these issues have proven to be sort of always a touchstone issues in the American experience. But the great thing about Bobby Austin is that he's a wonderful intellectual contrarian. So he's going to make certain that we have a lively debate and discussion. So with that, I turn it over to Marianne French.
Let's see, is this, can everyone hear? I'm going to say a few words, and then I'm going to have each of our panelists weigh in with an introduction, and then we're going to have a little discussion and then open it up for questions. White dancers and entertainers and sometimes criminals who sought to disguise themselves and hide their misdeeds wore blackface in England as early as the 1500s. They performed what they imagined to be imitations of African tribal dances. They were called Morris men, a name which is believed to have come from the word Moorish, which was used to describe a people from Northwest Africa who ruled Spain from the late 8th century to the 15th century. In the United States, many historians date the birth of blackface back to the mid-1800s or a little earlier, but other scholars have attempted to untangle the many strands of culture and race and nationality that were crossed and tied and mixed and confused, a convergence of poor whites and recent immigrants, African Americans in various gradations of freedom and bondage, laborers and artisans. They point to New York City as the place in America where the phenomenon of blackface first flashed into existence in the early 1800s. I'm not talking about the sometimes silly or foolish versions of blackface that were later taken on the road to theaters, or the derisive and deeply offensive versions that evolved later still that were deployed as weapons of racist and reflexive destruction. What I'm talking about, this earliest example of blackface in this country, a petri dish in New York City, was on a wharf on the site of the old Five Points intersection, a poor, very commercial crossroads of culture, race, and nationality. Folks made their living on the water as fishermen or other types of work, and those who worked on the fields in Long Island or Staten Island or other as yet undeveloped parts of the rapidly changing and urbanizing city. On holidays especially, these folks would congregate on the wharf at Five Points at a particular place called Catherine's Slip and perform, dancing and making music and sharing stories in forms of speech that, from our present day perspective, might appear to be forerunners of scat or hip-hop, while others would watch. In those crowds often were currents of respect and admiration for the skills and artistry of the performers. Whites would borrow from blacks snatches of slang or licks of lyrics. They incorporated dance steps into their repertoires. They were free, at least for the moment, to try on some of the blackness that pervaded the larger culture then and ever since. It could be passed along, but never truly possessed. That was one of the beginnings. Dr. Reece, the curator of music and performing arts at the Smithsonian's National Museum of African American History and Culture, will be relating the darker history of some of the blackface that followed, how it evolved and how it was potent enough to spawn, 2 centuries later, politicians who appear to be learned and well-educated men who pose, presumably proudly, for yearbook photos in blackface and KKK robes, or an incredibly high-paid network personality who claimed to be clueless and surprised by blowback from her endorsement of blackface for Halloween. Mr. Ezickson, regional director of the Anti-Defamation League, will talk about why and how it could be that in this day and age, this country needs to be educated about the damages done by defamation. And Dr. Austin, a sociologist, will take on the challenging task of trying to put all of this into perspective and to remind us that none of it is simple or easily understood. Dr. Reece?
Thank you. Is this good? You can hear me? Well, we've had an excellent picture painted, and I like to take a little bit of my time just to go back to that history and to illustrate how prevalent and pervasive minstrelsy's impact has been throughout the succeeding centuries that have followed. As we stated, it started in the mid-1800s, around 1830s, 1840s, and unbeknownst to a lot of people, it wasn't started in the South, it was started in the northern states. And what we had was a performance tradition in which white actors would blacken up their faces with cork or grease or whatever they had at disposal, and would caricature African-American life, cultural traditions, physicality in all kinds of forms. These caricatures were using song and dance, language, belief patterns and values, exacerbated into gross exaggerated characterizations from the physicality, the exaggerated lips and the bulging eyes, but to really objectify African Americans. And part of that history in a society where whites and blacks were brought together, but blacks enslaved and had a separate status, it was a method of separating the races and making sure that blacks were seen as inferior and ridiculed and not seen as human. So you think about minstrelsy and this impact and what it's setting up as a performance tradition. And then you think about the fact that minstrelsy was the first popular form of entertainment. So it was not only reaching people in the North, but it was reaching people in the South and the people who were moving out West. And so another point to take when you think about this entire history is to see how prevalent, and people who may not have engaged with African Americans or had firsthand experience, these are the images that they see. These are the characters that they see to see as real representations of who these of who African Americans really are. So take together the popularity and these images, you get to see a sense of how embedded minstrelsy became in popular culture and how embedded it came in the public's imagination. You fast forward into other mediums when we talk about vaudeville, we talk about musical theater, radio, recording, television, film. These caricatures began to take on a life of their own, and we would have blackface continue on into these mediums even to the present day. And also, even without blackface, you see the elements of minstrelsy from the jokes and from the styles and the performance traditions, you know, recycling throughout history and culture. It goes without saying, why should we be offended by blackface minstrelsy today? Part of it is the intention and its impact. The intention was to dehumanize, to objectify, and that is nothing about admiration or what some people think, that blackface is really a sign of affirmation, admiration, and really speaking to the positive qualities of an individual. The attention is key, is central. That history is wrapped up in that intention and supported with its long-term effect and its initial effect impact in the 19th century was to maintain the status quo in racial differences and racial lines that had been demarcated since the start of when the first Africans were brought here as enslaved people. And so this is wrapped into the fabric of who we are as a nation. And the argument is that this is a nation based in that dialogue and discussion and that tension about race in this nation and how it's played out in our societies. And it can't go without saying how effective popular entertainment, popular culture is in disseminating these images and being the way that people interpret each other, not only African Americans, we can speak to Native Americans, Latinos, Asians. And so when you start to think about this in this way and take away these images and see how they impact society, you begin to see how people tend to separate it from its infancy and try to relegate it to something that's known and accepted in everyday life. So when in engaging in this dialogue, it's important to talk about those intentions and what its impact was and not to separate it as something that's an aberration and something that is totally divorced from its historical origins.
Excellent, thank you. Mr. Ezickson.
Thank you very much. It's a true pleasure and privilege to be here, part of this distinguished set of speakers. For my organization, the ADL, which is really focused on advocacy and education around hate and inclusion and sort of the defense of democratic values, it's important to understand or to put hate in a construct. And we are committed to both advocating against hate and educating about hate. And in the education realm, it's critical, to Dr. Reese's point, that we understand, and I would argue first, the impact on the targeted community. It is not up to others, myself included, and the privilege that I enjoy, to be the judge as to what the impact should or should not be. And much, unfortunately, of the conversation we see in the public realm around any type of symbol of hate, although there is some belief these days that there are some symbols that are outrageous enough not to be tolerated, but unfortunately, as we have all experienced, even here in the district, whether it be nooses or swastikas or other symbols, they seem to be re-emergent in terms of their power and their acceptance on behalf of many groups of haters. But we have to understand, first of all, the impact. That impact, regardless of intent, merits a response. The type of response will be informed by perhaps the intent. But let's start with the impact. We believe that there exists in human history and in society what we label a pyramid of hate. That there exists a set of interrelated and ever escalating connections between what might appear to be jokes or historic prejudices that might be lightly incorporated into speech or into attitudes. Those biased attitudes, however, form the foundation of a pyramid, which will lead to, in many instances, as a natural progression, to acts of bias on the basis of the dehumanization, the characteristics embedded in the biased attitude or the slur or the joke that is reflected. And clearly, as we've heard, blackface origins were to demean, were to attribute to African Americans particular characteristics by people who were white and who sought to assert that dominance through a variety of vehicles, blackface being one of them. We cannot ignore that history, nor should we ignore the impact of that, even if oftentimes the communities that are targeted don't even understand fully the impact. But once those biased attitudes lead to acts of bias, we can document that in turn it results in discrimination. That people act, people in power, people in positions to affect the way people are incorporated or have rights in society, even in a democracy, will incorporate these acts of discrimination, which are validated by the very prejudice that has been rooted through these acts of bias and the biased attitudes. And we know that what leads from discrimination is bias-motivated violence. And we only have to look to the recent FBI statistics to see, for the third year in a row, in this political environment in which hate has been empowered, has been given permission, that acts of violence are on the increase, and acts on the basis of hate. And hate acts, as we know, hate crimes, are crimes motivated by virtue of the personal characteristics of the victim. They are not simply an attempt to deprive somebody of their possessions or of their personal safety, but rather they are also meant to be a statement that you, as a woman, as a member of the LGBTQ community, as an immigrant, a Latina, a Muslim, a Jew, an African American, have a lesser status in society and you can be targeted. And those acts of violence, unfortunately, in some cases, in recent memory, are used in the ultimate act of violence as a justification for genocide. And so we cannot lose sight of the fact that the pyramid or the slippery slope of a simple historic reference or an excuse that it happened 25 years ago, we do not let that pass in our society. We let it pass at our own risk. And so what leads from that is that every act of bias, the more visible in some sense from this construct, the better, is an opportunity to educate. And I hope we will come back to discuss some more about what is it about our system, what is it about the way we define education, that we can have adults and college graduates and students emerge from our education system with no understanding of the history of blackface, with no understanding of the history of genocide, the history of civil rights, and what our democracy was founded on. So this is a challenge for educators and for community members to say, we are going to draw a line under the hate that we are seeing right now, and we are going to change the vector of our society. We are going to invest in our democracy and invest in education in a way recognizing that biased attitudes lead to biased violence, and we will not accept it any longer.
Thank you. Dr. Austin?
Well, can you hear me? No.
Pull it a little closer.
Use them too loud. How about that? Better?
Closer still.
If I do that, I want everything to talk about. My notes are here. Okay, can you hear me now?
Okay.
Well, I agree with everybody. See, I'm changing.
That's not contrarian.
Is that a contrarian? All of a sudden, yeah, changes right that over. I agree with all of you. Well, not quite. The interesting thing about this blackface, and I guess we can attach race to it as well, but as you know by now, all of you are pretty well-educated people, almost all social scientists now are discounting the thing race. It is being discontinued. There is no such thing as races. There is one race. And you can do that biblically. The race of human beings, and you can do that biologically, which is the race of human beings. We're all one race. Different varieties, different colors, diversity. But what is so interesting about the blackface issue in America is how we tackle it, how we deal with it. Freud says in the first couple of paragraphs of Civilization and Its Discontents that he's talking about religion and how weak we are, that we need religion because we're so afraid and we're afraid of everything, and the world is just oceanic. By that he means this is so huge, it's just beyond anything we can contemplate. But he says, you know what though, we're in the world and we can't get out of it, so we got to live it. You know, I guess as a kid would say, you got to play the game, you got to keep on going, you can't stop. And how do you do that? Well, for some of us, that narrative changed after the fall of Rome, I guess, or maybe even later, after the Moors were kicked out of Spain by Isabella and her husband. And it was the same year that Columbus stumbled onto North America. And that's a very interesting thing. It's the same year that the Moors, who had been in Spain for over 600 years, changed the whole face of Spain, changed the whole face of Europe, which was coming out of the Dark Ages, brought them civilization. Don't tell anybody. But it brought them civilization because they kept records. And if you think about this, the ancients were not upset by this. There was a wonderful professor at Howard. Those of you who went to Howard probably had Dr. Snowden. And Dr. Snowden taught back in the day when people would discount anything the black people had to say. He said very frankly, the Greeks and the Romans would take their vacations according to their own writings with the blessed Ethiopians. Think about what I'm saying. What he's saying is that the gods rested with the blessed Ethiopians because they were so pious and so just and so beautiful. That is what blacks were in the ancient world. That changed, and that changed immediately upon Columbus discovering America. Not the first day, not the first 300 years, but it changed. The point I want to make is this. Things move and change in such strange ways in life. And how do we come to grips with those changes? I can be very upset with the governor of Virginia for his blackface. Because I would think a man of his intelligence and integrity would know better. But obviously, he did not. And it's something that Dr. Reece said, which I'd say all the time, it's all about intentionality. What did he intend to do? Well, I don't know. He'd have to tell us that. Well, let me give you a good example of intentionality. Picasso did some really weird paintings. Some of you who are artists will probably think I'm speaking heresy because you probably love Picasso. I like Picasso. But he changed the whole face of Western art. And how did he do it? He put an African mask on a woman's face. And it was called The Women of... Anybody with me? Well, I'll give you a test later on. But anyway, it was this beautiful, beautiful painting. And what he did was to lay a whole new landscape to look out upon, which was different from what the Europeans had been doing before. The art world hated him for it, but he changed the entire face of art. Blackface, then, I have five little pieces and I'm gonna be done, can be from that same image a change in how we see life. In the early ancient world, black Madonnas were worshiped. No, not the ones you see every day now when you go to the Catholic Church to pray or wherever you go to pray. They were not the ones. They were black. I have three in my home. I'll show them to you if you want to see them. They were in all the Romanesque countries. They were all over Europe. They were worshipped and praised because they were magical, and they did magical, miracle things. Secondly, I will come then to the minstrels. When you get to America and they become minstrelized, they do two things. They entertain. They entertain, are they being derogatory? But you have to think about that. Are they being derogatory or are they not? For instance, when you go home and your children have their music on and they're saying, bitch, ho, blah, blah, is that derogatory? And are you allowing that in your house? it sold millions of dollars, and people love it because it's rap, and rap is the world. It sells peanut butter, it sells Cokes, it sells cars, and it's as derogatory to black women as it can be, and that's the intention. Or is it? The intention is to sell. And we go right along with it. So commerce is number three after minstrel. But to understand that minstrel is, as Dr. Reece said, is the cornerstone of American popular culture. What is the most popular, what is it when you make a lot of money? The most financially successful thing that America imports to the rest of the world?
Entertainment.
Culture. Who's behind it? People cursing and saying all of our children that we're allowed to do that, that's the intentionality of it. But we don't think it's horrible. We think that's, you can do that. Or do we? Some of us do, some of us don't. Now, the issue becomes one, and I'm gonna be done after that. When I look at this, the modern day world that we live in, and I see this blackface, and I remember as a kid growing up, and you had Aunt Jemima pancakes, and you had, what was the rice?
Uncle Ben's rice.
I didn't get up every morning and say, I hate that rice because it's got that black face on it. I said, oh, Mom, we having rice? Because it was selling rice. And it was selling it because black people knew how to cook. I don't care what you say. That's why they were selling it, because you don't put crap on something you're trying to give somebody, they got to give you a dollar for it. Okay? Now, I grew to dislike it because I became mature, and I said, why are you doing that? Why is that blackface on there? And we come to understand that my intentionality as I grew and changed too. That I matured to think, that's not right. You shouldn't use that image if it's degrading. What does that degraded image mean? I believe two things. We can change this, as everyone has said, but you have to create a new moral mind in America. You're not going to do it by laws. We've tried that. You're going to have to think about, how do we say, when I am a part of a whole, like this nation is, we cannot get away from each other. Go and do your DNA. Most of you are going to be very afraid to do it. Let me tell you, give you a good example. I have a dear friend who is black, and she's, for all practical purposes, she's white. And she was going down to North Carolina to do her history, and she did it. And so she came back. She said, Bobby, you're not going to believe this. I said, what? She said, I couldn't find any of us. I said, what are you talking about? She said, no, I couldn't find. In the records, it didn't say color. It didn't say. I said, what did it say? She said, it said white. I said, what does that mean? Well, I knew exactly what it meant. You know, too. Even in that day, they were passing. They had passed themselves into a new race, into a new group. And some of them had changed back when they came to Washington, D.C. Now, what is the issue? The issue is, we are very much a part of the same family. And we are very much a part of a world that is somewhat confused. Blackface confuses it even more, because we don't know always what the intention is. The intention of a governor, of a man, a boy in medical school, is to make fun of someone. That to me is, I think, pretty obvious. Why would he do that? That I don't know. But have you ever done anything stupid like that yourself? No? Maybe not. I've done a lot of stupid things, and I don't even look like I do stupid things. But I have, because, you know, people do silly and stupid things when they're young. When they grow up, they want to change. So we must make some room for people to change. I do believe that. And I do believe we have to hold people accountable when they are of a certain age of what they are doing. I want Trump held accountable for everything, because I don't think he deserves a pass for anything. But I don't think the governor of Virginia deserves a pass. But what I'm saying to you is this. If we can move from the most blessed and the most pious people in the world by the ancients, this is not me saying this, I'm nobody. These are ancient scholars. That's who we were. That today, we had one man and a whole group of people and young people who changed the country to where we sit today, that we can say very clearly that America could be a promised land for all people if we can do what the ADL is talking about, if we can do what Dr. Reece is talking about, and even a little bit of what I'm talking about, and that is put on the mask of the African and see the world from a different vantage point. That's what Picasso did, even though he denied it. And I call that the Iberian principle. That is, when you do something, and then you know you did it, and then you deny it. We do the Iberian principle every day. Oh, no, I don't believe that. We go right and do the same thing all over again. That, I think, is the issue. And for me, I'm going to let it go there. That's my take on it. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Dr. Reece, you talk about the importance of intention. And my question, I think about people you hear talking today about institutional racism. And if we compare that to the 19th century, the beginnings of blackface, when some scholars say that whites who practiced blackface were really envious of some of the cultural talents of blacks and were trying to appropriate it. And you look at the lieutenant governor of Virginia who said he was emulating Curtis Blow when he dressed up like a hip-hop artist. How do those two things fit together in your mind? Do you think that it was a personal one-on-one intentionality, or was there an institutional element to it in the beginning?
I mean, the whole issue of blackface is very complicated. And when I talk about intention, I'm really looking at its origins and how it began and why it survived. I think in many ways, and we talk about the influence of popular entertainment and culture, and I just can't emphasize that enough, it helped to institutionalize that level of racism. There's a book that came out about, I don't know, 15, 20 years ago, maybe more, by Eric Lott called Love and Theft. Mm-hmm. And there are those theories that blackface minstrelsy was a way of engaging with African Americans, but also, you know, stealing their culture and their image. And it's the same thing how you can love and hate something at the same time. You fetishize it. And it starts to bridge into areas when you talk about cultural appropriation, which we're still talking about it today. And so part of that complexity plays out in minstrelsy. And part of the intention, and for me, its history and what it did in the past resonates in the future. And that's why, in my mind, I can see it as an offensive act and a troublesome act that leads to, you know, some of the issues of hate and bias and everything else that flows from that. And so that power, particularly in entertainment spectrum and the commercialization, and that in some ways it was entertainment, but it gave people what they wanted. And people wanted more, so they did more of that. And so that started to institutionalize a way of being, a way of seeing a group of individuals in a way that was dehumanizing, but also embedded into the fabric of our greater culture, our national culture, and national way of confronting the tensions we have with African Americans in these lands.
Thank you. Mr. Ezickson, you talk about the importance of education in ridding ourselves of elements of hatred and bias such as blackface. Can you describe in broad terms what tools or what kind of vehicles you use in education to head off such impulses?
It's a good question, and it's an ongoing challenge. I think we start from the assumption that we as human beings, and this has been referenced, it has been confirmed in several fields, whether it's in the context of implicit bias, the recognition that we each as human beings in our development from a young age are looking at the world and noticing differences and drawing conclusions about our place in the world relative to others, that there is a self protective element to the human existence that is distrustful of the other by design, by genetic design. There's a field of moral psychology, which is a very interesting evolving field, which looks to what is inherent in human nature that leads us to differentiate, leads us to assume perhaps ill of the other before we have a basis for that. And it's in that context that we have to understand that actually as human beings we come to every interaction with prejudgments, whether intentional or not, and that the danger of something like blackface is that it reinforces something we may not even be aware of, that its potency as a hate symbol. And I take the point that there is a history and that we need to understand the history. I very much agree that the intent of the folks who participate is relevant in figuring out how do we move forward, what are the implications of an act of hate. We deal with children all the time. There has been a flourishing of swastikas in schools in this area, for example, or of nooses in elementary schools, in middle schools and high schools, in communities where you would not expect such a thing. That is a mimicking of what children are hearing and seeing, and we see those as a particular moment for intervention and education as opposed to consequences that might be far more significant if they are in the context of a crime by an adult or by a political leader. But I think if we bring to this the understanding that we cannot understand the power of these symbols and the impact to our democracy and to this great experiment that we call America, and it is an ongoing experiment. We cannot meet the vision that was referenced in terms of all of us being a single race without tackling the very difficult issue of how we differentiate. And so the tools that we utilize are early intervention. We engage in conversation starting in kindergarten with children who actually, for the most part, notice differences less, although we know from the child psychologists and from educators that children as young as 3 or 4 are beginning to understand differences, right? So it's very important that we engage. It's giving vehicles for children to examine, to explore, to ask questions about that which they don't understand or differences in a safe place. It's about providing parents with vehicles. So we do a series of what we call table talks, which are guided conversations for parents to have with their children. How do you discuss blackface with your children? How do you discuss what happened in Charlottesville? How do you discuss the hanging of a noose at the African-American fraternity here at American University? And using these terrible opportunities not to only reprimand, which is appropriate, and take action to hold those accountable, but to use the attention as a vehicle to focus in on the particular issue. And then we train teachers to understand that this is a critical part of curriculum for every school and that it needs to be part of the conversation. And finally, empower students to have the conversations at every level themselves. We know the pedagogy from an education perspective. If we're trying to change culture and we're trying to eliminate the ramifications of hate that we see in schools, it really comes in the form of bullying. Right, so that is where we see kids ostracized for their differences, whether disability or race or gender identity. It's creating a culture in a school where that is unacceptable. That has to be led by the children. And so we have vehicles to teach children how to create a culture of acceptance, how to be not just agreeing to not engage in the conduct of criticizing or holding people to a different standard because of difference, but also to be an upstander, to be an ally, to speak out when they observe others engaging in that conduct. That's how we knit together from a societal perspective a tapestry that really does fight back against those prejudices, those fears that are inherent in us. But if we don't do it affirmatively, things will not change. And I think that is the main takeaway here, is that an incident, as painful as this incident has been and is, these incidents in Virginia, for example, with blackface, they represent an opportunity for a conversation and for a reintroduction of some basic historical concepts into our education system.
Thank you. Dr. Austin, I want to ask you kind of a variant of the same question, but on a level as cosmic or global as the one you used to approach the topic. You spoke about the effect or the use of science and the use of art in to get at this problem and its conception, its orientation. How do you ideally, what is the answer from that higher kind of plane? What would you use?
Well, I personally think that it's not that difficult. When you think about the minstrels and when they were out there and they were performing and they were giving an image in blackface, that was about around the same time, if I'm not mistaken, and Dr. Reese can correct me, that the Fisk Jubilee Singers were introduced to the American public. It was the first time a serious art form of African Americans performing on the stage took place. It swept the world, Europe, all over. They did it. Their intention was to save our school. I guess we need to do it again. but all black schools probably need to have a Fisk Jubilee Singers, because that's why they did it. But in doing that, they changed the whole cosmic atmosphere of who we were and how we performed and what we could perform and how we did sing. Even though the same ditties that they were playing the banjo on the minstrel, which, by the way, is an African instrument, as you well know, that we brought here. And then we stopped using the instrument because, why? It was tainted, so it became country music. And I grew up thinking that the banjo was a country music instrument, and it is, but it wasn't at the beginning. So what I'm saying is it can be very simple. I think UDC, I used to be here and I love this place, could be a wonderful incubator for building the moral mind around science and around music and art, because that's where you're going to change it. We live in a very sophisticated world. People don't change just because you tell them to. People generally will not change if you tell them to. If you tell your child, do not go outside that door, what will they do? Go outside that door. Because we don't like, I'm going to tell the truth. I didn't like Bernie Sanders the last time around. I'll just tell the truth. I don't mind saying. You know why? I'm from the South, and having a white guy pointing his finger at me was like, no, I can't. And I know this man is brilliant. I'm liking him now because somebody told him, put your finger in your pocket. Don't point at people. There are certain people, that sign is not a good one. It didn't affect you, but it certainly was one that affected me. And I talked to people, and they're saying, you know what? I felt the same way. It was like he was lecturing me, and I couldn't get it. But I'm saying to you, is there a ways that we can do this that are very simple? We don't have to go 30,000 feet. We really can. UDC could be a prime incubator for something like this. We've integrated three schools, made it one. One, a white woman who started a school for, she called it Colored Girls. And that's okay for that day, but African-American women. One, a tech college. And for a tech college, I'm sorry, and which was a wonderful tech college, and one of very, how shall I say it, Federal City was what I would call a real 1960s imprimatur on education, and put those together, and you have a wonderful institution. I believe that's how it's done.
So you're basically talking about injecting morality into each of the disciplines?
Yes. Yeah. And bringing in your professors, bringing into their curriculum everybody that should be in a part of that genre of work that you're doing. Don't push others out. bring everybody's voice into that curriculum. I think that's one way you can do that. And parents, stop asking your children, which we used to do, and we stopped. Our children don't do it. We would say, oh, you play with who? Is he black or white? You know, we did that. And you have to honestly tell the truth, because we don't like to tell the truth most of the time. Because we didn't know whether it was going to hurt my child, because he was at this school or they were out of school. And you wanted to know, well, who are you playing with? And they would say, oh, I love so-and-so. I said, well, is he black or is he white? Wrong thing. Or on television, somebody gets killed. First thing, it goes, oh, was he black? I said, oh, good. The white person who killed another white, it's okay. But if it's black, it's like, oh, my God. You see, those things are instilled in all of us, and we do them unintentionally. We don't mean ever, but because we don't want to be harmed again, we don't want that to be looked at as scapegoating us. We want to move it away from us. I'm saying that we can put it right here. It could be a curriculum thing. I think Sharon is getting the best part of it by having these discussions on how we implement history and policy. And move it so we have a discussion in this whole city, in neighborhoods, and in homes about just the kind of thing we're talking about here today.
Thank you. Yeah, can we open that up? And yes, sir.
I don't know if it's done much anymore, but 20, 30 years ago, people used to collect black memorabilia a lot. And I'm wondering if one or more of you would share your impression of black memorabilia, which you know has many of the caricatures and stereotypes and tropes that you talked about. And does it matter if it's being collected by a black person or a white person?
Who does it matter? Intention? you know, my mother collected black memorabilia, and for a lot of African Americans, it's collecting the history, it's telling the authentic story. I can't speak for whites who collect black memorabilia. Once again, also, it's a commodity. Mm-hmm. It's fetishized. It's rare. We don't know. But it is a reflection of history and telling a story and making sure that people don't forget. Don't forget how these images have portrayed African Americans, how prevalent they were. And, you know, our commercial cycle is as such that when something popular, collecting African-American memorabilia is now popular. There's so many people who have been doing this for decades and decades, and a lot of those people came to the museum finally finding a place where they could leave their objects. They were doing it before it was popular or before anyone else was doing it. But then the market starts to dictate what's out there and how it's used and why it survives. So, you know, as someone was saying, people are doing things that may not even be aware of, and it's so embedded into the fabric of society that when we talk about history and making a place that is an incubator for exploring these ideas, we can't overlook the way that some of history is shaped by culture and history shapes culture. And even with the education in our homes and in our schools and in our colleges, what's circulating out there has much more power than what we do at home. And so we have to, how do we get our cultural messages, images, all those ideas to reflect the moral ground to help shape people? Because a lot of that history, people are only going to get from a film, a cartoon, a magazine, music. And we have to really grapple with that as well, because that power is unimaginable. And we see it today, even with the latest, the market was Gucci and somebody else. It's circulating in the marketplace. And so there's this a powerful hold that these images and the history and the legacy that Blackface minstrelsy holds in our whole world. In our cycle of life.
Another commercial aspect of it is Halloween. And how we celebrate Halloween. The Pew organization did a poll just recently in the last month on attitudes about blackface and posited the question, you know, is it acceptable to do, for folks to put blackface on for Halloween? And over a third of Americans said sometimes or maybe always yes. what does that reflect? I mean, that is it, the ultimate commercial enterprise, I think, in celebration of I'm not sure what in America. And yet, this attitude about blackface, to bring it back, prevails among a third of Americans. Interestingly, it's around 40% of white Americans, 19% of African Americans indicated, yes, it would be acceptable, all or sometimes, depending on the context. So I think that's another commercial lens, which wasn't quite your question, where we see this arising.
And I would make more and more point as we kind of talk about this in the abstract. There's tremendous pain in these images, and there is a need for empathy. And we should restate that over and over again from a human perspective, that these images, this appropriation of someone's identity, this caricature of someone's identity, brings pain to another individual. And the sense of humanity and how these images have had this kind of effect on a fellow human being. And we shouldn't forget that, the psychic toll at having them reappear over and over again.
Good point. Yes.
Yes, I'd like to ask the panel. I'm sorry. I heard two people mention the Moors of Spain, okay? And at the time that we got here, it's obviously no coincidence that the development of Spain was also seen as an idea to come over to the Americas and develop. So I guess I have a two-part question. One of my questions is, how possible would it be to tell the truth about history when it comes to the African-American community and get those truths once again into the policy, into the schools? Because it's painful because you don't have a true image. You don't know the truth of the building of New York, of Five Points, and who built the buildings of New York, or who built the monuments of Washington, D.C. You can't find any pictures of the actual builders. You see them being built, but you never see the people. So this is a question of identity. If I were to unpack the history of blackface, we're basically talking about identity. If you know the truth of who you are, then somebody calling you a name doesn't affect you at all. And the other part of my question is, this is directed to the gentleman from the Anti-Defamation League. You have had in the past black organizations that have sought to uplift themselves through the truth, and meaning groups like Marcus Garvey, the Nation of Islam, and other groups that I'm not guilty of harming anybody in the sense of what you would call a hate crime, but simply dealing with the truth of things and dealing with a truthful history, that have been attacked as haters. So you kind of have that dichotomy where if you're too much of a lover of your black self and you say who you are, I did build this place, and you become a hater. I'd like to have some kind of answer to how you get beyond those barriers to progress.
I think it's yours.
I think you put your finger very much on the dilemma of how do we inject into our education, into our formulation of who we are as a country and who we are as a society, that reflects the truth from the various perspectives of the peoples who exist here. I mean, the diversity of our country is our strength. You won't hear that from our leaders necessarily today, or from many of our leaders. But I think but clearly what enables our country to commit to the kind of freedoms that we still pursue, that I don't want to say we're there yet, is a recognition of the nobility of all individuals and the potential of all, regardless of race, religion, creed, gender preference. And that is the aspiration. But again, that has to be intentionally attended to for it to prevail. And I don't want to sound too esoteric here, but that is, I think, at the root of our challenge as a country, is how can we interject into the formulation of the next generation's vision of an identity as an American, as opposed to any particular creed or religion within America, a common sense of tolerance, of understanding, of curiosity about the other, and recognizing that there are multiple narratives that knit together to create who we are on an ongoing basis. As to the second part of your question, I would challenge the characterization that at least our organization is labeling people who are doing for the community in that role as haters. You know, the issue of Nation of Islam is an issue we can discuss, you know, further offline. There's a particular current within the leadership of the Nation of Islam that they articulate related to the role of women, of people of the LGBT community and the Jewish community that we have called out and we will continue to call out, because it is exactly contrary to what I just articulated, which is it is an attempt to characterize, to isolate, to suggest that there are those among us seeking to undermine the rights and that fundamentally there is something you know, that is wrong with these communities that seek to do harm to others. So, but in terms of your aspiration, I agree with it 100%.
I'll just briefly say, you just hit the nail on the head. You see how we have had two wonderful expressions of a point of view which don't agree with each other, because one of the things about the Muslims, it brings to the fore very conflictual ideas between certain groups of blacks and certain other groups in the community, particularly Jews and LGBT people, because of some of the things that they say. Some people think they're wonderful, some people think they're horrible. Now, the point about America is you have to put that in the context of where we can discuss it without everybody getting all upset and hot and bothered. Blackface is just the same, it's the same kind of thing. And when we can get to that point where we can discuss it, like ADL has wonderful materials, I've used them many years, others have these materials that we can use to get to that point. A university is a perfect place to do that kind of discussion. But it's not the kind of discussion where one group is powerful over the other group. It is where you have to listen to what I'm saying and understand. I tell people, and I do speeches, I do a lot of work on the American common culture. And you can ask people, and they'll tell you, I said, I would not want to live in America if there were no black Muslims here. Even though I don't belong, don't want to belong, would never belong. The NAACP do belong, have always belonged, will continue to belong, and the Urban League. Do you know why? Because I think they have my back if the war came. And don't tell me it won't, because we're looking at 40% of white Americans who are fighting a war against poor immigrants trying to come in from South America. We shouldn't play with these things. They are real. And they're happening every day. Venezuela is a real-time thing happening with us, and I don't know what we're saying about it or doing about it, but it's about oil. So if we're going to be at a university and we're going to be real university people, you've got to take on real issues. I'm not going to ever join the black Muslims. No one, I could never wear a bow tie. I just would look foolish in one. And I'll make it derogatory in that sense. But I have worked with them when I did a housing thing out in Southeast, and I tell you, people listen to them. Now, when they come to the table to talk with people, my friends who are Jewish don't understand, why would you say that? I said, but it's only because I feel as vulnerable in America as you do, because I am black. And if you're white, you may not feel that same vulnerability. So that's a discussion that we have to have. When we each feel safe with the other, when we know you're not going to abandon us and I'm not going to abandon you, then you can let other things drop off. And that, I think, is a clear and present danger for us today if we don't begin to confront these issues and do them now.
I think we have a question over here.
I think we've all but forgotten Megyn Kelly.
Mm-hmm.
Megyn Kelly, you know, got fired because she was going to wear, I think, blackface for Halloween. And she says on her program, I don't understand what's wrong with it. And then the next thing I know, everybody knows, she was fired. I think it was an excellent opportunity if management at NBC had said, this is a good learning opportunity.
Absolutely.
To teach America.
Mm-hmm.
And have her come on and say, I didn't learn this in school, but I have learned it now.
Yeah.
And I think we need to discuss it, how it would offend people. So I think it was a lost opportunity to take a national TV station and discuss this issue and have to discuss it ongoing on other issues similar.
So, yeah, we were.
Do you agree that she should have been fired?
Well, I think what the lady is saying is we didn't get a chance to know. We don't know what was her intention for doing it. I mean, was she just being stupid and simply saying, oh, everybody should have a, you know, how, I don't know. I mean, I really don't know.
But you know, it's when we talk about having conversation and safe spaces, you know, in having those conversations, we can't demonize people right. for raising the question. Do we want to educate them or do we want to prove how right we are? And go ahead.
We were talking about this earlier, that it's interesting the difference between the fallout from Kelly's firing versus the Virginia politicians who seem to have started a whole firestorm of reaction. Why is that? She professed to be clueless at the time.
Well, and she could have been correct. I mean, a long time ago there was a study done, and it looked at what people read in newspapers. Has anybody, as a sociologist, ever read? And when they looked at it, whites read nothing to do with either Negro in the title or Black. They went right past it. Where Blacks read the whole newspaper. Why? We had to know everything that was happening. They didn't need to know that Q-Sci-Fi was going to be down on the playground playing tomorrow with the kids. That was not of importance. And I think that's exactly what Dr. Reese is saying. You know, you have to sort of, you know, we have to be open with safe spaces for people to talk. I think that is the difference. I don't think that when you look at the constituents of this man saying, let him stay, well, who can put him out? If whereas a big company can say, no, we don't want you anymore. You're going to have to go. It's a different thing. But as she was saying, suppose they had said, let's really talk to Megyn Kelly. Have a call in. Now, you didn't get this. You don't know this. Do you know why people are upset and why you were fired? And let her talk about it. I think we could all learn something from her.
Do we have another question?
How you doing? I would like to thank everybody for coming together for this conference, and I think it's very needed and anticipated. And as an African American male, college graduate, and also a teacher, I would like to propose the question of how do you feel about it starting at home? Because I think the first teachers are the parents, and if you want to tackle the issue with race, I believe if we as adults and parents actually have more interaction with our teachers and not just colleges, but high schools, middle schools, and elementary schools regarding on how do our parents view about race. And if we can tackle that early on, I think that the children of the next generation can actually put an end to this racism. So I would like to ask, what is your view on that at the point?
You want me to start? Okay. You know, I do think, you know, adults raising children, that if they're open to teaching and exposing children, I mean, the question is about acknowledgement and inclusion. It's recognizing the humanity in each and every one of us. I think you set that groundwork. You know, you can't educate a child with something they haven't been exposed to. And you have to set that foundation, and you have to set a strong enough foundation and a way of approaching life and exposure that can withstand, once a child gets into school, there's all kind of influences, and they're listening to their peers more than they're listening to their parents. And, you know, those of us who've raised children, we know how that happens. And so I think education has to come on all fronts. But I think as parents raising children or people teaching in schools, you can only educate so far if people are not engaged with the rest of the world or see someone else's history as their history. And we're all implicated in this. I mean, one of the things we talk about at the museum is the African American story is the American story. So it's not just about reading Absolutely. When you see Black and Negro. It's taking all of it. You know, the question of who's watching Black films and who's not. This is an entire story. We're all part of this. And we need to acknowledge and include that and, you know, structure our lives so we represent that and recognize the humanity in all people.
I just want to follow up on that to say briefly, that is exactly what I'd lecture on. It's the American common culture. We all share an interwoven culture in this country, and that is very, very important to know.
And I'll just comment that I don't think it's either or. I think you make an excellent point that the extent that we can have children begin in an environment that recognizes the humanity in everybody, that is critical, and it also can immunize, in a sense, inoculate kids against what they may be exposed to when they get to school. But I will tell you that one of the most common complaints from teachers that we get are the attitudes that kids bring from home. Mm-hmm. That they also have to deal with, because it's never going to be 100%, and there's a certain dynamic that kids have. And as has been stated, kids don't listen to adults at a certain level, right? There's a degree of peer pressure. And so empowering kids to talk about tolerance themselves, to make that cool, to make that the standard by which everybody wants, and to celebrate each other's cultures is, I think, the core challenge. And where do we come together as a society? There was a time where military experience as adults was a common experience in our society, for better or worse. We don't have something comparable where all parts of society come together and interact and are exposed to one another and to one another's prejudices and can form friendships and relationships. We're more atomized than we've ever been. We live in groups isolated from one another. And by the way, we haven't talked at all about the little innovation that has changed all of this called the internet, if some of you have heard of that, which is the ever-present voice in the room for our children and for us, and we still don't understand the full implications of that. So to counter that voice, to counter the hate that you can find at a click, and the characterizations of people that you see in images, and that it's hard to avoid them, in fact. You don't even have to go looking for them. We know that is creating even more divisiveness in society. The antidote, though, has to be equally powerful. And that's a challenge we all face. And it isn't going to be in only one place.
Another question?
Yes. Good afternoon. I'm Bill Rice. And I have this question. Is it all right now for, say, a black man to dress up at Halloween as Barbara Streisand? Is it all right for a white woman to dress up as Geronimo at Halloween? And if you don't mind identifying yourselves as you answer, I came in late and didn't hear the introduction.
I think we're all going to think about that question. Is it all right for a man to dress up as Barbara Streisand? And is it all right for
a white woman to dress up as Geronimo?
A white woman to dress up as Geronimo. Well, I would say that if you went to New Orleans, if you are, if you like New Orleans and you like Mardi Gras, King Zulu is a major part. It is the major part of Mardi Gras, and they dress up. They dress up actually in blackface, and they're black.
Black makeup.
Ah, see, you learned something. It's not cork face, right? The point is, I don't know. I think if you are daring enough to dress up as Barbra Streisand and you're a man, go right ahead. I used to dress up every Halloween. If you can go up down 16th Street and say, you remember that man who used to dress up like Dracula and open the door? I've scared so many children crazy by answering the door as Dracula. So I, you know, have fun. I think life should be fun. I did it. I don't know about anybody else.
And I will say this because it's a complicated, I think about culture, which I'm really rooted in. Who can dress as whom? Who can appropriate someone else's identity, culture, what have you? And the difference would be, the difference between cultural appropriation is history and power. And the difference, what is cultural exchange, is acknowledgement and inclusion. And once again, if you start to think about that, it's the intention and it's the way that people, I mean, appropriation's very complicated. It's something we talk about in music all the time. And what is actually going on? Is it appropriating? Are you are you using your power to profit? Or are you going through a cultural exchange and you're acknowledging and being inclusive in what you're doing? So I think there's a fine line, and I think there can be both. But you have to, once again, think about the intention and the impact and who gives, not permission, but what is actually going on in that exchange and that act of taking on other identities. It's very difficult to parse out, but it's something to keep in mind, those differences and how that divides those two instances.
So I'll just add that in America today, where hate has been empowered, where bigots have been given permission, where people act on their prejudices through continued violence, some of which has always been there, some of which is expanding, the answer is no. Do I aspire for a country where every person is treated equally for who they are? Yes, and in that dream society, then the costume would have no offense or no risk of offense. But I think we have to understand the moment in time in which we live. And I would argue that there are plenty of ways to celebrate without taking the risk of offense or of appropriation. And that we have to acknowledge that this is a time, a critical time in our country. And that would be my position, even as I would understand if somebody would say there is no harm intended, I don't understand why offense is given. Well, look at the context. Look at what we're dealing with right now.
If and play devil's advocate, but there are instances, and even with blackface, you're talking about it, where African Americans would don blackface, or people take on things to signify and subvert the messages, and whether it's their identity or to comment on the objectification that they experience. So there is that element there too, that I'm not sure any one person can and tease out for another person, but people use the things that are used to objectify things to comment on society in a way, to express themselves personally and to fight against the hate that these images often represent.
Mm-hmm. And if I could just add something brief about the King of Zulus. In some reading I did for this panel, I learned, of course, that people from Louisiana feel very strongly about the Zulus. I also found out that Louis Armstrong was the first black man ever to appear on the cover of Time magazine. And it happened in 1949 when he was elected King of the Zulus. And they printed a picture of him with his crown and kind of a comical grin. So, that's one perspective. Another is I learned that during the Black Power days, the height of the Black Power days, late 60s and early 70s, the Zulus almost disappeared because there was such social pressure from blacks for them not to appear. So that was fascinating for me.
The Zulu Club organization is 115 years old.
Exactly.
And it is Mardi Gras now in New Orleans, and they will march on Tuesday. Mm-hmm. And they have been asked to march without black makeup. Mm-hmm. And the reason Zulu started with black makeup was that when Mardi Gras parades marched in early 1900, all parade goers had to wear masks, and they couldn't afford masks, mm-hmm. so they painted their face black.
Exactly.
And so that is the tradition for mm-hmm. Zulu. So do you give it up after 115 years because they're saying it is not black face, it is black makeup, and it is their history for doing that?
I absolutely agree with you, and I think that's exactly what I was talking about. That is the intention. They are not making fun. They're having fun. They are not making fun of anybody else. And it is a very well-known tradition among that queue in that Mardi Gras. You know, one of the things that I love about being in the scholarly world is we take everything extremely seriously, sometimes to our own detriment. I go to a wonderful church, and about 15 to 20 years ago, our minister said, you know what, the worst thing that ever happened to us is we learned Robert's Rules of Order, because we could never get anything done. Never, 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 because everybody knew Robert's Rules, and they were looking in their book, and, you know, and so, and finally we said, don't bring them anymore. We'll just take a vote up or down. Sometimes you have to be very sure what you want in the long game. What is the long game that we want in this? We want our children and our nation to be whole. That's the long game, is it not? Is that not what we all want? And how do we get there? And central to this culture is the African-American experience. You cannot have an America without us. I said at the beginning, we cannot fall out of this world. We're in it. And the long game is how do we play that? And I'm done.
In using the Zulus as an example, it's an example of becoming reactionary instead of educated, mm-hmm. because there are nuances if you understand the history. And so we can't go completely. It's not a question of black and white, no pun intended, but it is nuance. And people will come back with examples in the discussion about blackface. You know, what about someone dressing in whiteface or someone dressing up as a woman? And I'm not sure the question is to shut it all down, because then you're looking at a cultural, social, community history that's erased, that was very meaningful for important reasons. And so more of the exercise and part of that education is to understand nuance, to understand history, and a way of developing critical thinking skills that you can tease this out instead of saying, well, if this has to go, then that has to go. We really need to understand and empathize.
And I guess my only point there is, to clarify my comment, is I don't want to judge, and I don't feel qualified to judge the impact of my decision to appear as somebody else, right? That's a judgment each community can make in terms of what is offensive or not, or how they want to express their power. But I think if we want to be whole, we have to recognize that what we think may be fun can actually be a caricature that is that has embedded in it great pain and reaction, and that we should presume that we have other ways to express ourselves and be conscious that our own ignorance may result in pain. And if we can get there and create a neutral plane in which we can interact and come to understand each other, as again, I hope we aspire to a time where I would understand the characterization that was appropriate or not of every other, I will admit that I don't. And so if I don't, I am not going to presume that what I do will be without offense to others as we try to build and knit this society together that we're talking about.
Well, on that note, I'd like to thank you all for an enlightening discussion. It's truly fascinating. Enjoyed all of your comments.
Thank you.